You did that. Today we're blessed to have the pastor from Davis Park Church come and give us the message. Let's give a warm church in the park welcome to Jordan Coss, Pastor Jordan Coss.
All right. Well, good morning. You know, it was an honor back in June when I was down to preach the first time. It was an honor to step aside and let Dean preach his first sermon ever for Church in the Park. So no problem whatsoever there. It was an honor to let him do that and to be a part of that and to hear that that day. I kind of feel like I'm in a scene from the movie Up where I just want to go, squirrel, you know? So if I do that throughout the sermon, that's why. Okay, I might be kind of like that dog in that movie. But I'm from Detroit originally, and so go Tigers, right? Yeah, this is a safe crowd to say that, right? No. But when I say that I'm from Detroit, a lot of people say, "Well, did you grow up on 8 Mile?" And I'm like, "No. I mean, look at me. I didn't grow up on 8 Mile." Some people say, "Hey, do you know Eminem?" I'm like, "No, I don't know Eminem." But some people say that I could rap like him. No. I'm as white as you can possibly be. Got no rapping skills. But I got a friend of mine that I lived with one time who grew up on 8 Mile, lives on 8 Mile. But it's not 8 Mile in the city. It's eight Mile way out on the country west of the city where it's a gravel road. But my hometown is outside of Detroit, actually. It's south of the city. It's called Allen Park. And my home congregation in Detroit was called Lincoln Park. And now I'm a minister at Davis Park. So I like parks, all right? I like church in the park. That's why we're here. But Friday I was writing my lesson for what I was going to say today for church in the park. And I went out to a park to write it. And as I was sitting in a park writing this lesson for church in the park, I was listening to Lincoln Park. And a song came on my phone. I was listening to Spotify. And the song, I don't know if you heard this song by Lincoln Park, it's called What I've Done. And the song goes something like this. In this farewell, there's no blood, there's no alibi, because I've drawn regret from the truth of 1,000 lies. So let mercy come and wash away what I've done. I'll face myself to cross out what I've become, erase myself, and let go of what I've done. Put to rest what you thought of me while I clean this slate with the hand of uncertainty. For what I've done, I start again, and whatever pain may come, today this ends. I'm forgiving what I've done. And the chorus goes on again. So let mercy come and wash away what I've done. I'll face myself to cross out what I've become, erase myself, and let go of what I've done. So let mercy come and wash away what I've done. This time period right now in this fall, there's a 10-day time period that happens every fall known as, in the Jewish faith, the High Holy Days. And I think this time period has a significant lesson to teach us, not as Christians, as believers, as humans. And during these High Holy Days, what it is there's two particular holidays that happen in the fall, in the Jewish faith. The first is Rosh Hashanah. Even though Rosh Hashanah is the Jewish New Year, okay, that happened on Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. It's a two-day holiday. And what Rosh Hashanah means, again, is the Jewish New Year. And in the Bible, it's not called the Jewish New Year. It's called a day of loud noises. And it's like every time I sing is a day of loud noises. Oh, yeah. But what they do on Rosh Hashanah, on the day of loud noises, they blow a trumpet, a shofar. I don't know if you've ever seen a shofar, but it's a ram's horn. And ram's horns are kind of twisted and spirally. But they blow it over like 100 times that day, really loud. So that's why it's called a day of loud noises. But one of the things you do on Rosh Hashanah is you celebrate God as the king and creator of the universe. And so that begins the High Holy Days. And that again, that happened on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday this past week. And what ends the High Holy Days is this next Friday is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the day that the sins of the people of Israel are atoned and forgiven for throughout the past year, so that God can continue to dwell and live among his people in the tabernacle and temple. It's the one day out of the entire year that the high priest would enter within the veil of the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was, where God's throne room, where God resided. And he would sprinkle the blood of the goat on the mercy seat, the Ark of the Covenant, to atone and find forgiveness for the people's sins, including his own. We know what's interesting, though. Between those two holidays, and this is where I'm going with this, between those two holidays, it's known as the days of awe. The 7 days in between the 2 days of Rosh Hashanah and the last day, the 10th day of Yom Kippur, known as the days of awe or days of repentance. The Sabbath, the Saturday that falls in between those two holidays, is known as the Sabbath of return, the Sabbath of repentance. So this is a time period right now that we're living in, but also I think every day, as we're going to get to at the end of the lesson, this is a time period of introspection, of self-examination, of repentance, and of action, of trying to make things right with everyone that you have done wrong to in your life. It's a day, it's a time period, these days of awe, to confront what I've done, what we've done, our sins. So if you look at Rosh Hashanah, I want you to turn to open up your Bibles and turn to Genesis 22. One cool thing about Rosh Hashanah is that the one passage and story that's read on Rosh Hashanah is Genesis 22, and that's the offering of Isaac, Abraham's only son. So turn with me to Genesis 22. And we're going to read that a little bit. All right, if you got your Bibles, here's the story of Abraham, the man that God called to begin his people. Eventually, that's where the people of Israel eventually came from this first dude, Abraham. And it goes like this. Now, it came about after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said, take now your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac, his son, and he split wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him to. Seems like the story is leaving a whole lot out about Abraham's reaction to God asking him to kill his only son, the son he's been waiting for his entire life, which he's like 100 years old, and God promised him like many years ago that he would eventually have a son, and now God's asking him to kill him, to offer him as a sacrifice. And it's like, Abraham's probably like, what's going on here? But in verse 4, on the third day, Abraham raised his eyes and saw the place from a distance. Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. And I and the lad will go over there, and we will worship and return to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked up the mountain of Moriah together. Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, hey, Dad, here I am, my son. And he said, hey, Dad, behold the fire and the wood, but where's the sacrifice? Where's the lamb? For the burnt offering. And Abraham said, God will provide himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together as we wonder what in the world is going on in Isaac's head as he's walking up the mountain with his dad without an animal. Then they came to the place in verse 9 of which God had told him. And Abraham built the altar there and arranged the wood and bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. And he said, do not stretch out your hand against the lad, your son, and do nothing to him, for I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham raised his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in the thicket by his thorns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the place of his son. And Abraham called that place, he named it, the Lord will provide on that day. In the mount of the Lord it will be provided, as it is called to this day. That's the story of Abraham offering, God asking Abraham to offer Isaac, his only son, as a sacrifice. Now, it's the kind of story, again, that makes you question, how in the world could a good God ask Abraham, the dude he's called and promised, that you're going to have many children after you, you're going to be a great nation. How could a good God ask you to do something like this? But as you read on, and especially as you, from the Old Testament, especially as you get to the New Testament, you kind of go, oh, okay, now I understand. Because God provided a ram instead of Abraham's only son. The squirrel's up there again? Yeah, Brian. I see everybody's eyes like, huh? Squirrel. God provided a ram. Maybe even a squirrel it was. No, it was a ram. Squirrel's too small. God provided a ram instead of Abraham's only son. Now in Jesus, get this, God provides his only son, his one and only son, instead of it being us. So God provided a ram instead of Abraham's only son. In Jesus, God provides his own only unique son, Jesus Christ, instead of us having to take the knife. Because you know what? We deserve the knife that was going to go enter into Isaac, but eventually entered into the ram because of what I've done, because of what we have done, because of our sins. We deserve the knife. But God provides a way through the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ for salvation. If you look at the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, Leviticus 16, that's where we find God talking about, hey, here's what you do on this holiday. And it's the day, again, that a high priest enters into the Holy of Holies to offer the blood of the sacrifice of the goat so that the people's sins are atoned for. You know, Leviticus, I don't know the last time you ever decided to read the book of Leviticus, but I recently went to the dentist these past couple weeks, and it wasn't good. They found four cavities in my mouth. Had the whole drill thing, numbing your mouth and filling them in with all that kind of stuff. I don't know what they filled it with, but apparently it's supposed to work. And you know, it's that time where you talk to you look up at the dentist and he's asking you, have you been flossing? And you say, and you lie and say, yes, no, no. You say, no, I haven't been flossing. Reading Leviticus is kind of like flossing. Follow me here. Reading Leviticus is kind of like flossing. You know you should do it, but you don't. You ignore it. And so finally when you do, it hurts. And by the end of it, you're bleeding so much you can offer a blood sacrifice. Okay? Yeah. All right. But God's plan the entire for creation, for his people that he has made, is to dwell among them in the midst of them. And God dwelt among his people there, the people of Israel, through the tabernacle in the middle of the camp where everybody else was camped around him. So God dwelt among his people there. And in order for that to happen, his people's sins had to be atoned for, had to be forgiven. And the only way that was possible was through that sacrifice of that goat, the blood of that goat. But through the blood of the goat, God provided a way for him to dwell with them. He provided a way for that to happen. And we deserve that veil. You know, I mean, and this goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden. We deserve that veil that separates God's people from his presence, from the Ark of the Covenant, from his throne room. The day that Adam and Eve sinned, God had to kick them out of the Garden of Eden, what was set up in place? To keep him out of the garden from re-entering. But an angel, a cherubim with a flaming sword, you know, kind of going back and forth, they can't enter. And what they stitch on the veil in between the Holy of Holies and the rest of the tabernacle, but a cherubim holding a sword, you know? It's kind of like we deserve that veil because of what we've done, that we deserve separation. We deserve not dwelling with God because of our sins. But God has provided a way. God has provided a way to dwell with us forever. It's not because of anything that we have done, because we don't deserve it, because of what we've done. God has provided a way to dwell with us, and he plans on returning and doing that soon when Jesus comes again to dwell with us forever and for us with him. That's his entire plan. He does not want to live separated from us, but he has provided a way through the blood of his one and only son, Jesus Christ, who now is our great high priest who has entered within the veil through his death and burial and resurrection, and he has dropped anchor there, Hebrews 6 says, and nobody can move that anchor. But God has provided a way. You know what? These 7 days right now that we're living in between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, they are the days of awe. But since Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and before he returns again, every day is a day of awe. Every day is a day of repentance. Every day is a day that we need to self-examine ourselves and prepare for God fulfilling his plan and dwelling with us forever. Today and every day, in light of Jesus, is a day of awe. This morning, I got up. We had an early service at 8:30. I don't know. I can't believe it. It was hard to get up for an 8:30 in the morning service. But I got up, and I got dressed, and I got out in my car, and I live on Virginia, close to downtown. And what I didn't know was that there was a marathon or 5K going on. I don't know what was going on, what it was. But okay. But they just so happened to make a perfect box around my house, the neighborhood around my house. So I was like, I tried to get out via Virginia. No, they turned me around. I tried to get out via McHenry. No, I'm sorry, you can't go this way. Try to get out Needham. No, I'm sorry, you can't go this way. Try to get out College. No, I'm sorry. And finally, I was just like, look, I got somewhere to be. I got to go to church in the park. And you guys got to let me through. And they're finally like, okay, well, just wait for a break in the runners, and you can get through. And eventually that happened. Yeah, I know. But what I've done, our sins, is kind of like that box that you just can't get out of. There's no way that we can possibly get out on our own. But it's only through God that he provides a way. And in these days of awe, our sin and what I've done is confronted with a holy God. And when our sin, what I've done, is confronted with a holy God, there's no way out. I can't get out myself. But God provides a way. And he forgives what I've done through his son, Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection, and the forgiveness that we receive through his shed blood on the cross. What he asks of us is to just simply put our faith and trust in him. Put our faith and trust in him this morning. Examine yourself. Understand that we're all sinners. We all have fallen short of the glory of God, and we all deserve the knife. We all deserve to be separated. But through Jesus Christ, what he received through his death, burial, and resurrection, and being raised the third day and sitting at the right hand of God, what's his is ours. We can be called children of God. We can receive resurrection. We can have eternal life if only we put our faith and trust in him today. And so, return. Repent. Let mercy come and wash away what I've done. We're going to have a time of invitation at this time, and I don't know what you normally do, but right here, right now, we can possibly have Dean come up. I don't know, but if you want to respond in any way, I'm standing up here. There's a prayer team that's going to be up here as well to receive you. If you want to in any way ask for prayers, or if you want to commit your life to Jesus Christ, we would love to help you out in any way that we can this morning, as you can come forward now.
Jesus Christ, his Son. Let the poor say